On behalf of the Government of Canada, on behalf of our Prime Minister, the Right Honourable Stephen Harper, I would like to congratulate Mr. Paul Wynne for truly exemplifying the ideals of Senator Yutsik and the spirit of the award bearing his name, and for contributing in such a pivotal way to our diverse and vibrant Canadian society.
I must also acknowledge a man by the name of Robert Sargent. He was among many caring Canadians that welcomed the Vietnamese boat people to Canada after the war. He helped countless young Vietnamese families, including my mother and father, integrate into Canadian society. He offered knowledgeable guidance, compassionate care, and served as a loving father figure. We affectionately call him Uncle Bob. There's a gentleman by the name of Robert Sargent, you know, that he was working at a local church, and you know, one day he saw, you know, some Vietnamese youth who just came to Canada. They were just out hanging outside of a building, you know, kind of loitering in a way, and Uncle Bob approached him and asked him if they, you know, needed help.
And just around the corner was a hotel called the Waldorf Astoria, where unsponsored refugees were housed by the government.
They didn't know any English. They didn't have any money. They just came with the clothes on their back. From the stories that my father told me, you know, it was difficult, you know, basically integrating into society. He didn't know English. He didn't know the basic things that we take for granted here in this society, you know, whether it was, you know, taking the TTC. How do you do that? You know, how do you look for a job? How do you pay rent? How do you go, you know, there's so many things that we do here in Western society we take for granted, but just imagine, you know, someone literally, you know, fresh off the boat, and, you know, they have nothing here, and they have to learn the ropes.
I worked right around the corner from the hotel where the government put up unsponsored refugees. And every time I went to lunch, I walked by the hotel, and there were these little groups of young men standing outside the hotel, basically with nothing to do. They had a little plastic bags with all of their belongings in them, and I decided that I ought to do something.
My parents, they came to Canada, I think, you know, late 70s, probably 79. And, you know, they were, you know, they were fleeing the Vietnam War. And basically they came over on boats. You know, many of the refugees came on boats. They escaped. And, you know, from all accounts, we understand that it was a very dangerous trek.
There was nobody to help them, nobody to find an apartment for them. Nobody to show them, as it were, Canadian life. I was moved. It was really, I won't say it was an emotional thing, but it was something that I felt that I was called to do.
And basically he helped, you know, he helped them feel welcome. He accelerated the learning process for them to, you know, to understand how society works here. And he's been instrumental in their success, including my own.
And one of the things I did was to go into that hotel and knock on the doors and speak to the person who came to the door, introduce myself, and say, I've got a car outside. I can take you anywhere. What would you like? Actually, in total, there were about five or six families that I was involved with. They weren't families originally. They were just young men and women, mostly men. The reason why there were no young women was that these were true boat people. They had been floating in the water in the South China Sea in leaky boats that were attacked by pirates. The women were raped. They were stolen of their money, their jewelry. Their children were thrown into the sea, and they had come to Canada under terrible conditions. And I had feelings for them because of that. What can I do to make their life the beginning of a new life, to make it better?
I guess when my parents came to Canada, it wasn't supposed to be a permanent thing. They were just escaping the war, and I think they were planning to return to Vietnam. And I actually didn't know this. I actually found this information out through Uncle Bob. It never really occurred to me that my parents didn't even bring it up, that they were actually, you know, when they had me in Canada, that we were going to go back. And for sure there'd be less opportunities. I'd probably be working in the fields or something, making a dollar a day, and you know, breaking my back in the sun. And, wouldn't be able to have an education like in Canada, you know, going to high school. People take these things for granted, but, you know, high school, going to post-secondary, you know, having the fortune of going to university and pursuing your goals and dreams, it's been really good.
I took them to the place in Toronto called the Annex, where at that time a lot of apartments and places were for rent. We passed by one that had a sign in the window, apartment for rent. And very soon they came back and told me that it's for a lady. And I said, they can't do that. That's discrimination. So I went over with them to talk to the person in that house, the landlord. I had a calling card which had my name and the Anglican Book Center on it, and I gave them my calling card, and I said that I'm helping these people find places to live. Well, my calling card changed their attitude. They showed them the apartment, and they took it.
If my parents didn't meet Uncle Bob, I think things could have turned out quite a bit differently. I know a lot of Vietnamese people who came to Canada, you know, they would get an early start, either working at a factory if they were lucky, or you know, another popular occupation for, you know, Vietnamese people who don't have English is, you know, worm picking worms for bait. And you know, these guys would wake up in the morning, go in the trucks, and the windows would be tinted because, you know, they don't want people to see inside, but they would go to the, you know, farm area or wherever, and they would pick the worms, and they get paid by per worm. He owes a lot to Uncle Bob, who basically, you know, helped him learn how to navigate through Canadian society and, you know, learning English and, you know, knowing how to access different services and also not being taken advantage of. Because sometimes my dad would get into some sort of trouble. His English wouldn't be that strong, but he can call up Uncle Bob and Uncle Bob would just show up and help him.
I thank God for bringing me this far. And I think that the Vietnamese community has been part of my journey.
Our relationship with Uncle Bob is actually pretty strong, if not stronger. For myself personally, you know, I've grown closer to Uncle Bob because now I'm, you know, moving into adult life and spending more time with him and having, you know, deeper conversations. I basically learned a lot more about myself and my family's history because he would have this information and he would be sharing it with me. Because it's not like every day I would sit down with my dad and mom and ask them about the history. You know, we just live life normally day to day. But Uncle Bob has taught me a lot about myself, you know, my history, where I came from, and also my family's history.
So I think in that respect, I must have made some kind of an impression on them. They've kept me as a member of their family, and they tell me that. So that when we go out for lunch or dinner or something, or when one of the families has an important event, they always invite me because they consider me part of the family. So whatever I did and however I did it, I must have done the right thing. Because there is a bond among us. You could call it a bond of love, a bond of friendship, a bond of family. I'm called Uncle Bob, and I love that. And this has been an outgrowing of this relationship. So if you want to, for me to evaluate or say how I feel about how much I influence them, I think their actions say it best.